Dear spectators, we shall now continue our Wagner series coming to its last parts. And first I shall deal with Wagnerism, this cultural movement in the whole Europe, which was started already in his lifetime. And then deal with some special cases like Ludwig der Zweite from Bavière, and then especially the French reception, which was very strong movement in France, and then coming at the end to Jean Sibelius and to Nordic countries and Wagner reception here. Anyway, Wagnerism as a phenomenon has been studied by the Finnish historian Hannu Salmi. He has published this interesting study, Wagner and Wagnerism in 19th century Sweden, Finland and Baltic provinces. But also about Wagner's nationalist ideas, Die Herrlichkeit des deutschen Namens was the title of Hannu Salmi's dissertation. Anyway, perhaps the most perfect Wagnerian of his lifetime and very important person in Wagner's life was, of course, Ludwig der Zweite or Louis de Bavière. This king who lived 1845 till 1885. So that's a rather young life which Wagner anticipated when he had familiar with this young king. He said that he is so noble, ethereal, so fine spirit that I wonder how he can live in this world. Anyway, about Ludwig, we have to remember that that he was educated quite normally, but his father died 1864, and then Ludwig became the king of Bavière in 1865. And in the coronation ceremonies, his whole physical essence and outlook raised much attention. He was very tall, he was extremely sportive, he was a good rider and swimmer, and he behaved very with fine royal manners and was very kind and to everyone. And his reign was altogether quite efficient. His name has been put in 100,000 documents which he signed. He was in person interested also in the modern industrialization and modern technology. For instance, he invited the Siemens electronic factor to provide the lights to his castles. And he was also even interested in airplanes very early, which was considered as a sign of his crazy nature. Anyway, Ludwig had read quite young Wagner's writings, his Zukunft der Das Kunstwerk der Zukunft and many others, and he was even given the Das Opel und Drama, which was fascinating. But he was not allowed to go to see Wagner's operas. His father, Maximilian II, considered that it was not quite proper for a young man. However, he saw Lohengrin finally, and then he became an absolutely passionate friend of Wagner's music. Now, we noticed that when Wagner came to was in exile in Stuttgart, then Ludwig sent one of his men of his court to greet him, Mr. Pfistermeister, to give him a letter and then also money to support the totally despaired artist in this phase. And that was of course the decisive change in Wagner's life altogether. Then Ludwig supported Wagner in every respect and wanted to perform all his operas in Munich. He wanted to build there a huge Wagner opera theater with architect Gottfried Semper, who was one of the greatest of the time and also a friend to Wagner. But this dream of big opera house in Munich never came in reality. Instead, they performed there many of his operas, and Ludwig saw a lot of his music. Now then, in his life, there were many disappointments for a political reason, nature, namely, Prussia became very strong and wanted to subordinate all the German counts and counties under its power, and so Bavaria gradually lost its independence and became only an ally of Prussia and later Germany. In the war between Prussia and Denmark and Schleswig-Holstein in 1866, I think Bavaria had to support Prussia, and then in the Prussian France War 1870, Bavaria had to fight with Bismarck. This was very disappointing to both Ludwig and his brother Otto, younger brother Otto. They had to attend the coronation of the Emperor of Germany in Versailles. But Otto wrote that it was terrible, only the German boots and German spirit everywhere that we are lost. And Ludwig namely was very much for the France and French culture. He admired greatly the France in every respect. So they then both Ludwig and his brother, they gradually turned inside to their own fictive, illusory, imaginative fantasy world. And Otto became insane rather quickly after these war events, for which he was testimony himself. Ludwig again started to build his projects, his castles. First at Linderhof, he built the famous cave of Lohengrin underwater, where he could by boat and swans be there, and then he built Neuschwanstein started in 1870s, early 80s, and which was done as a renovation of the or new castle in the style of Hohenschwangau, which is another castle in the side of the now Neuschwanstein. Neuschwanstein is nowadays very famous. It's in close to Munich, in the mountain area. It's very close to Austria. There are still forests there of pine trees and spruces. And if you go there, let's say on a lone moment in November, you see it's fantastic atmosphere. The whole castle was in the medieval style, and every hall was based on Wagner's operas. So there were paintings, fresco paintings, made by famous painters belonging to the idea historical painting school, and portraying just Nibelungenring, Lohengrin, and others. Most of these heroes in paintings, they are, however, in the antique style, they are antiquizing. They are not looking like the later in Bayreuth, the singers dressed in old German furs, but they were just like antique heroes. Ludwig lived himself only some 8 months spent in this castle, and he did not think that it should be some kind of monument for his own life or Wagner, but just as a Wagnerian environment in which he would have a great time. Now then, these were of course terribly expensive, and so he consumed the whole cash of Bavaria state, and his ministers were more and more worried about their king, what is he doing. However, the Germany supported all the time Ludwig, and they gave more, Bismarck gave more money, but when the money arrived to pay the debts, then Ludwig used them immediately for new castles. And so he built Herrenchiemsee in an area, it's to the south of of Munich, a castle which was copy of Versailles in close to Paris, but it is bigger than Versailles. However, if you go there, it's of course admirable, but somehow it's empty, vague, because nothing historic ever happened there. So it is just only castle and nothing else. Now then, at the end, the ministers wanted to get rid of Ludwig, and they invited the famous psychiatrist Dr. Gudden to write a diagnosis that the king was mad. Simply, he was paranoiac and had all kinds of visions which were not at all normal. And so they could force him to abdicate, or rather, he was just taken by the police and brought to the castle of Starnberg, in which he that happened in 1884, I think. So Wagner himself had already passed away, and there Ludwig, after one period, he went to walk with his doctor Gudden, and then they both disappeared, and they were both found in the Lake Starnberg ground. So probably Ludwig had tried to escape by swimming to the other side of the lake, because we know that his cousin Sissi, Empress of Austria, had their sailing boats already on the sea, on the lake, waiting for Ludwig. And Ludwig was excellent swimmer and rider, so it would have been possible. That was a mystery, after all, what had happened, but it's another story. Now we might have a look in that movie, Karl Freilich, 1913, Wagner's life. There is one scene between in which Ludwig and Wagner, they meet, and this somehow looks rather authentic by their gestures and how they behave there. So. So we know that the Wittelsbach Bacher family, here I have the book Geschichte unserer Familie, is from Princess Adalbert, Prince von Bayern, has been written down, and as you know, they all had almost tragical fates, because Emperor Franz Joseph was then shot in Sarajevo, which caused the First World War, and then Sissi was murdered also, so they all had very bad. Here is one guidebook to Neuschwanstein, portraying Ludwig in his younger years. And interesting document is, of course, this correspondence between Ludwig and Richard, and also with Cosima. This correspondence has been published in several times. Here is just one collection of letters. And this style is very interesting. It is extremely elevated and noble. They call each other something like mein innig geliebter, mein einziger Freund, or in ewiger Liebe und Treue, der ihrige Richard Wagner, and in such style, mit innigster Liebe ihr, and ewig ihr treues Eigen Ludwig, eternally yours, Richard Wagner, it's in English. Meines königlichen Erlösers, ewiges Eigen. Eternally, my royal redemptors, eternally own, Richard Wagner, ewiges Eigen. And then there are, we quote motives, here is from Parsifal, durch Mitleid wissend, hilft nur der eine, because Ludwig called himself Parsifal. Ludwig came sometimes to meet Wagner, and then he announced himself as Parsifal or Walter von Stolzing. So he totally identified with the figures in Wagner's operas. You know. Well, this very emotional style should not be understood incorrectly, like the American New Musicology scholars do. It was just discourse of that time typical, and it did not mean it was not to be taken literally. It was just figurative language which was quite common. And also we have the correspondence between Cosima and Ludwig. It also had been published. We also had, and they tried to keep all the time, of course, the Wagner family the best possible relations, because Ludwig was their mecenate who just funded everything. So he had very tragical fate. He was not crazy at all. He was only opera crazy, you could say. And after his passing away, Bismarck wrote about him that he was excellent king, and his royal fantasy created artworks which we could only appreciate, and he knew more about government than all his ministers together. That was said by Bismarck. Bismarck about Wagner was not so positive. When they met, then Bismarck told later, "I have never seen so ambitious a person. What does that Wagner want of me, after all?" And so we know that Berlin never supported very much Bayreuth, its festival, and so it had another story then. Now, that's Ludwig. France, of course, is quite privileged in the position of these Wagnerian countries of Europe. And in fact, this French Wagnerism started as early as Wagner's stay in Paris. Baudelaire wrote in his Écrit sur l'art, famous poem, Correspondance, "La nature est un temple vivant où les piliers laissent parfois entendre leurs sombres paroles, où les couleurs sont et parfums se répondent." But Baudelaire also wrote about one chapter, Tannhäuser, à Paris, and in that chapter he also portrayed Lohengrin prelude. He wrote a program, literary program, how to his mind it was describing how the Grail, the vase of the Grail, is brought down from the heavens on the earth, and how then it returns back there. Also, Franz Liszt wrote a program of Lohengrin in these years. So, started a strong movement, and even Revue Wagnerienne started to be published in 1880s by Theodore Viseva, Desjardins, and many other French intellectuals, and Wagner had a very great impact on the emergence of modernism in poetry. So Stéphane Mallarmé was Wagnerian, and many others. And now in this French Wagnerism, also the composers, they're of course under his power, and we can trace in many cases, many of them, they were just Wagnerians. In French music, 1870 meant also the birth of Ars Gallica. They started this idea of the Gallic art, but it was at the same time very Wagnerian, which is paradoxical. But this society, Ars Gallica, French music society, which was established, had names like César Franck, who is in his harmonic language is very, very harmonic. And this prelude, choral et fugue, is perhaps one of the most typical. Interesting here is the musical language, namely this so-called E-muet. So it's like je vous prie, so you have this pre-EMUET at the end, it is the same in music, just that you make the phrase very, very short by that bit. But then, of course, in this, the choral theme is something other. We have here first a song. Parsifal. The blocks are Parsifal, so it's the Parsifal motif, directly taken by Sitar Frank here. And then, of course, at the end, we have this idea there is a fugue in between and very chromatic. And then at the end, this fugue and the choral theme, they are all superimposed. A set of combination just at the end, and then we still have. So César Franck was definitely one of those Wagnerian composers. But so was also Gabriel Fauré, who wrote, as you know, much many songs and many. Piano music, especially piano was his special, and Fauré's ballad Opus 19 for piano was written inspired by Wagner's Siegfried opera, definitely. So. Especially, we could hear echoes from Siegfried's Waldweben part in these trills. We have this very highlighted. Of course, like the others, they visited Bayreuth. There were always big French delegation. Also Saint-Saëns, who was not Wagnerian as a composer, visited and was in the ouverture of that opera house. Then comes one composer who is very, very Wagnerian by his name, namely Ernst Chausson. When Chausson, whose output is not very big one, but has some operas which are definitely written in Wagnerian mold, like Le Roi d'Artus, for instance. It is very close to Tristan by its theme, and also the idea to use this old mythology and historic sources. Chausson, his best known piece is, of course, this poem. Very close to Tristan. So, and of course, there comes the main theme. For a violin piece, perhaps the best known piece performed, premiered by Eugène Ysaÿe once, but very, very Wagnerian. Now, it has also a literary origin in the friendship of Debussy and Chausson and their summertime in the countryside of France, in which they were reading literature, but that's another story. But Chausson, perhaps the most Wagnerian piece he wrote was his last major work, the quartet for piano, violin, viola, and cello, A major, opus 30. And we immediately hear, even on the motivic level, it's Wagnerism. It opens with this theme. Have this Parsifal motif, like in Franck and like in Parsifal. So, but here it is in A major anime. It's very Mediterranean, full of cheerful nature. And for a very long time, we have no idea that from which country this music is coming. But then comes the. It's obviously, it's close to Impressionism. Second movement, again, is rather typical. It is now in D flat major, so we move very, very dark. But it is a little bit modified. At the end we have just a very clear psychological program for the whole piece. Last moment is balladic and very dramatic, you could say, in the. But these harmonies, the author notes are already just the late Wagner. is a balladic. But then quite at the end, the themes start to return. There's a rebirth of these themes in a very Wagnerian way, we could say. And we are here. This fortissimo, very it's, and then the violin continues alone, tre retenue, and then it turns at the same time when we have this, so very powerful effect, and very Wagnerian, I would say. So we have these definitely composers who wrote in the spirit of Wagner, but I must come also to the other arts, because of course the painters adapted Wagnerian ideas. There were many painters, one of them, Fontaine Latour, oops, I don't have it here just now. No, anyway. But Fontaine Latour made a lot of symbolists, so it was also symbolism was this movement under which it came. But of course, maybe the most fascinating case of Wagnerism is, of course, the great novel writer Marcel Proust altogether. And of Proust, I take some materials now here. So, of course, Wagner had always a rather ambiguous relation with France. He had very bad experience in Paris, but however, he was also at the same time fascinated by French culture, and he had French admirers. One was this literary lady, Judith Gautier Mendes, who was a young lady. Here is, he published a visit, Richard Wagner, visit to Wagner in Switzerland, in Triebsel, where he came with his two men, namely Catulle Mendes, his man, and then poet Villiers de l'Isle Adam. And they were, of course, already very fervent Wagnerians, and received by Richard quite positively. Wagner did not like at all that people just unexpectedly appeared there. But Judith writes here, "Nous avions le fanatisme de sectaire, prêt au martyr, et plus encore à l'égorgement des adversaires." So we had the fanatism of sectarians, like Martyrs, so they were quite. Jamais nous n'aurions imaginé qu'un jour nous pourrions contempler la face du maître, qui était pour nous aussi inconnaissable que Jupiter au fond de l'Olympe, ou Jehovah derrière le flamboyant triangle. So we had never imagined to meet this great face of the great master who was as unknown to us like Jupiter at the, in the depths of Olympus. He quite concretely portrays this, and it's very exciting how the Frenchmen behave there. Tous les soirs à 8 heures, nous avions eu beau nous en défendre. Tous les soirs à 8 heures, la porte du salon s'ouvrait et Jacob annonçait le souper. So, souper was important for Frenchmen, but le souper se composait de viande froide, de salaison, de gâteaux, de fruits. Le maître aimait à y joindre du champagne de son ami Chandon, qu'il fallait boire sans scrupule, disait-il, car il en recevait un cadeau de son armateur français, plus qu'il n'en pouvait consommer. So they had the cold meat and then salads and then sweet things and fruits and then favorite champagne Chandon, which Wagner had got as a gift from many bottles, he couldn't drink them alone. La parole du maître, violente, joyeuse, passionnée, toujours sincère, produisait sur nous une impression intense, pour ainsi dire, magnétique. So the speech of the master, violent, cheerful, passionate, always sincere, produced in us an intensive impression, so to say, magnetic impression. So they were right. No, Cosima knew to take this this young lady who just was fascinated. She took it quite reasonably. Juliet wrote that when she arrived, then Wagner suddenly looked deeply in her eyes and said that I think there is a very intimate understanding between us. So Wagner had his friends and. Then in the wartime in 1817, of course he was in favor of the Germans who occupied, and he even said that he was only glad that Louvre is in flames and that Paris was burnt, because Paris also represented for him all the negative in the European world altogether. So. His wife Cosima, she was a French lady who only acted very German, who he had converted into Protestantism and who tried to be more German than Germans altogether. So, I go to this Marcel Proust, because here are the selection of his correspondence, Marcel Proust. And as you see, very, very much read. And of all the composers, Wagner is the most often cited, and then comes Beethoven. As quite young, Proust filled a questionnaire by British, I think for a magazine, who are your favorite composers? He did that even quite young, I think only some 12 or 13 years old. And then he said that the painter was Meissonier, and then composers were Gounod and maybe Mozart, I remember. But then later, when he was over 20s, he said that the great composers were Wagner, Beethoven and Schumann. So he had definitely very serious musical taste. We know of Proust's musical talents. Of course, Proust is known by his huge novel series, A la recherche du temps perdu, which is something like some equivalent to the tetralogy of Wagner, but in literature, I would say. And by the way, I published a study on that in which it's in this semiotics of classical music, in which I analyze this. And I even try to say here that Proust's novel is Ekphrasis of Wagner's Nibelungen in tetralogy. What is ekphrasis? Ekphrasis comes from Greek language, and ekphrasis in the antiquity meant just in rhetorics, a very clear speech about art. Especially it was used to portray how we verbally describe sculptures. But anyway, we can say that ekphrasis is the manner in which with one art we speak about another art. Let us say we speak by painting about music, or we speak by music about theater, or we speak by literature about music, like in this case of Marcel Proust. And so I have dared to compare altogether these two magnificent artworks, the most, maybe the most fundamental of the European art of the turn of the century, on this basis of ekphrasis. Now about Proust's life, we know that Wagner had there a very, very deep impact, and he was completely Wagnerian. Proust did not have any musical education properly, but he was able to play a little piano. He had a pianola at his chamber in Boulevard Haussmann, and there were score of Tristan, piano score of Tristan there, and probably he was able to use this piano score. That was absolutely the most important channel to receive orchestra opera music in the time without electronic recordings. Now he was, and then he, when he, as asthmatic, as you know, he had to withdraw definitely to his house without being able to go out, especially in the daytime when the streets were full of dust and traffic. He used to call a theatrophone, which was a kind of primitive radio or telephone. It was connected on the stage of Paris Opera Garnier, the great opera, and then he could listen to performances directly by this radio. And in that manner, Proust had heard much of Nibelungenring, Tannhäuser, Lohengrin, Mastersingers, and Parsifal, especially, which was his favorite opera, Parsifal. He was very loved music, and if he made dinners at Hotel Ritz, he would invite their musicians to play, and a pianist. Once he had one dinner, Gabriel Fauré was invited to play piano, but he was unable. Then Riesler, another pianist, played. And the program had, of course, I think it was Wagner's yes, Prelude to Mastersingers as a piano arrangement, as some kind of interesting number there. Then he could also invite whole string quartets at his home in the nighttime. For instance, Capé Quartet experienced such nightly invitation to play Debussy's quartet, and Poulet Quartet was invited once the home of alto violinist of the quartet door was knocked at 3 o'clock in the morning, and the mother of the musician went to open, and there was Marcel Proust on the street. And he said, I want to hear now Fauré's quartet immediately. So they gathered the members of the quartet, and they left for Proust home and played him what he liked. And then Proust, of course, paid them very, very richly for this. So there is very much music, and the truly musical scenes are, of course, the famous sonata of Van Tuy, who is a fictive composer, and then his septetto, which is reconstructed from sketches by Van Tuy's daughter and daughter's girlfriend, when the father had already passed away, and so these are the moments. If we think that how was the music of Van Tuy, many scholars say that it was very Wagnerian, especially the Good Friday music from Parsifal was said to be one model. Proust never himself revealed something. It may be Saint-Saëns, maybe sonata of Franck for violin and piano and many others, but impossible, because he only tells about this petit phrase in which is for Swan, one figure there, and his beloved Odette, their national anthem of their love relationship. He says that there are five notes, of which two are repeated. That doesn't help very much understand it. But the Wagner appears when he portrays the salon of Madame Verdurin, bourgeois salon in which music is played, and where also this septetto of Vinteuil is performed. And Wagner is certainly the most exciting they can ever imagine. So Madame Verdurin is sitting there, his face red like the goddess of migraine and Wagnerism, they say. She tells that if you play Wagner, I get so confused that I don't know if I say good morning or good evening. So it's so important. There are many moments in which Proust talks about Wagner directly. For instance, one interesting is his travel description when he made a car journey, automobile journey to the Baalbek to see the old cathedrals which were neglected. So he was following John Ruskin and wrote an essay, En mémoire des églises assassinées, les églises sauvées, les clochers de Caen, la cathédrale de Lisieux. These car journeys were possible by his young chauffeur, mechanic, Agostinelli, whom he had hired. And he writes about this when they get home, that the horn signal of the car, which through its uniform call like fixed idée of their approaching joy, pushing to their ears and increasing their growing anguish. And I dreamed how in Tristan and Isolde, in the second act first, when Isolde waves her scarf as a sign, and in the third, after the arrival of the ship, it is at the first time said penetratingly as an indefinite and always faster series of two notes whose succession emerged by accident in that unorganic world of noises. It is the second time the whistle of a poor shepherd with Wagner, with an increasing intensity and unmitigated monotony, with his congenial power of creation, lets he convey the most wonderful expectation of happiness that ever can fill a human soul. So that is the scene in which the Tristan and Isolde, they rush to their garden to have that very, very long scene of their encounter. Proust also writes about, he mentions just the Tristan, then the interesting sound of the hammer blows of Siegfried, which he heard, and then like birds, resembling not Lohengrin's swan, but the aeroplane I had seen at Baalbek turn its energy into elevation. So he compares it to the airplane, some motives. And by the way, this figure is repeated at the end of the whole series, when he portrays the First World War, when Germans attack Paris, and the Zeppelins come from the skies like the Valkyries. He compares the Zeppelins with Valkyries, their tune is like that. And by the way, that literary figure was, as you know, used in the cinema by Francis Coppola in his Apocalypse Now, in which the Valkyrian ride is used as a diegetic, so real music which the pilots use when they are bombing one Vietnamese village. So it's really real Wagner, and it is part of the plot, because the pilots, they really put Wagner on very loud in the aircraft when they are doing this bombing. They say, put it louder, that I want to hear it. So Wagner is giving such a role. Proust's major advisor was composer Reinaldo Hahn, lived 1875-1947, Venezuelan-born composer who was his very close friend and who gave him advice in musical matters. But Reinaldo Hahn was definitely anti-Wagnerian. Hahn did not like German contemporary music at all, and especially Richard Strauss he despised. Wagner, he did not accept, and he knew only one singer, Lili Lehmann, who had been singing with Wagner in Bayreuth, who had been able to preserve his. A La Recherche du Temps Perdu, Wagner appears so in many times, some compare it or to Debussy, Spellers et Mélisande, and Madame Cambremer, namely, exclaims that what a masterpiece Spellers is, I simply adore it. And drawing closer with the gestures of a female savage seeking to have her way with me and making use of her fingers to pick out imaginary notes, she began humming something that I supposed for her represented Bella's farewell. I think it is even more beautiful than Parsifal, she added, because in Parsifal the most beautiful things have had a certain halo of melodic phrases added to them, obsolete because melodic. So the members of the Salon, they are not musicians. They can say almost whatsoever there is. In some points, Proust comes to a very profound philosophy of music, and that is totally astounding because he was, of course, not at all trained in musical theory. Some have explained, for instance, his Tristan motif. This fa, la, fa. It's the same like if we transpose it. It is sol mi. This American Richard Goodkin said that it's the same as oh sole mio, because the narrator had heard it by Gondolier, and so. He thinks that it's the origin of Tristan motif is the Italian O sole mio by Gondolier. That is rather funny notice. And also in other cases there's a play with words like Odette, that Demimonde lady is a small ode, let's say, and Swan is Schwan, the swan, the mythical animal of the Wittelsbach family, and also in of Lohengrin. So, and then of course the whole concert taking place at Madame Verdurin is interesting because Proust shows that musical communication does not have any center. So it is not in the score, not in the performance, but it is not in the at the composer, nor at the listener, but it is everywhere at the same time. So that musical communication is not linear, so message coming from a sender, message receiver, but it goes in all directions all the time. This means that there is no such thing like musical object, objectively, we would say, but music exists in all its phenomenological forms, whether it is idea or composer, whether it is something in the instrument, whether it's a performance, whether it is just listener and aesthetics, his reception. So it can be all this together. So that is quite modern view on nature of musical communication, I would say. Proust is really full of Wagner, and I just want to say that his philosophy goes rather deep. He talks about the immortality of soul. There is, by the way, one study by Proust in Immortalité, the lamb, like many other times. But here, Proust writes that maybe it is the nothingness that is real, and our entire dream is non-existent. But in that case, we feel that these phrases of music and these notions that exist in relation to our dream must be nothing also. We will perish, but we have for hostages these divine captives who will follow us and share our fate. And death in their company is less bitter, less inglorious, and perhaps less probable. Perhaps less probable even. That is something very, very interestingly said, that that these melodies we take, they are the divine captives which we take in our mind. Proust had a theory of the double. He said that in fact we don't communicate with real persons or real things, but we communicate with the double, the double of that in our mind, much more than with any real thing. So in music, we have, if you go to Wagner opera, you have already the double of the opera in your mind. And what you hear, then you compare with your double. And so in the everyday communication. That is also a very exciting theory. Now I have studied this Wagner-Proust relation also quite systematically and academically, I would say, by showing that both in Proust literature and music Wagner, we have the same levels of articulation, we say in semiotics. Namely, in Proust we have the symbols, the highest level, semantics, syntax, metrics, and lowest the phonetics. And then in music we have the highest isotopies, so the meaning levels, signification, discourse civilization, actor reality, and substance, musical substance matter. So I have this diagram here, as you can see. And they are all levels are unified by what we call a semantic gesture. So that notion comes from the Prague formalists, both from Jan Mukajowski and Roman Jakobson, but it is there. And using this model, I compare systematically Proust prose and Wagner's musical prose, metaphorically. And notice that there are a lot of similarities and parallels between these, but I have no time here to go in detail in this analysis. In this, let's say, French world, I would dare to put also my own novel, Le Secret du Professeur Amfortas, which has appeared, of course, in Finnish first in 1990, but this appeared, this translation by Mikko Kuusimäki in 2000, published by L'Harmattan, Lettres Nordiques. This is totally Wagnerian novel, namely, but it had this had rather nice reception in France also. Certainly it fell down to that, but maybe a kind of modern Wagnerism, but the novel plot takes place in the future, so it is a kind of science fiction. It is not a detective story. That was a serious mistake in Finland with Finnish version. People thought that it is a roman policier, it's a detective story. And it was sold in the kiosks in that category. No, it takes place in Americana, future state when the Europe has been destroyed by somehow. And Americana, it takes place in two campuses. So this is a campus novel in two universities, Northfield and Southfield. And Professor Amfortas, you hear the name Amfortas, coming from Pasifa, is an important figure there. But whose problem is he had become quite mute, he doesn't speak anything. And so there comes his grandson, Sebastian, who is of Finnish origin, and tries to reveal the secret of his relative, Professor Amfortas, and many other figures are also carrying the names from Parsifal, like the evil professor of competing universities, Rosgnilk. Rosgnilk, so it's anagram from Klingsor. Turn it around and get Rosgnilk. And then there is Professor Titurel, and then there is Pierre Virtuoso, Gudrune Gundrisdotter, which is certainly also reference to these figures. So one example, so that how Wagner is just evoking and launching many kinds of projects in the arts. We shall now continue with Wagnerism in other parts in the Europe, and let's go to the north and to Finland simply. But before that, note also that Wagner had his counterpart Johannes Brahms. The Wagnerianer and Brahmsianer, they were two parties. The Brahms party believed in the symphony and absolute music, and their supporter was the musical critic Eduard Hanslick, of course. By the way, Eduard Hanslick had been ironically paradised in Meistersinger. In fact, the Beckmesser figure, that Meistersinger who strictly follows the rules and he was quite ridiculous, was a portrait of Eduard Hanslick. Now, Hanslick was first friend of Wagner, but he learns that he was paradised in the opera. He got really totally hostile, and his criticism is very severe, beginning from that, about all his operas. But anyway, we have Brahms, who we often think that he is something quite different from Wagner, but after all, it's not quite true. We have in Brahms also quite obvious Wagnerian features. Let us only think, let's say, of his early Opus 5 is an F minor sonata, and its main theme. Is very Wagnerian. It's almost like the Siegfried motif. It's very, very in the spirit in Wagnerian. And then in some other movements here, we have the slow movement is very Tristanesque, I would say. Here is also a quotation of one of poetry by Sternau. Der Abend dämmert, das Mondlicht scheint, da sind zwei Herzen in Liebe vereint. Und halten sich sehr umfangen. So the evening darkens, the moonlight is there. There are two hearts in love united, and they embrace each other. So it is that. And then the music we have is. Thank you. this descending third. Ring motif almost, but broken in this part. So we have that movement. It is very slow, very long nocturnal movement, evoking us the. And then intermezzo before the finale, Rückblick is kind of. Funeral march atmosphere here, obviously. So we have in Brahms definitely these moments in which he comes very close to Wagner. And then, of course, Wagner had his great admirer Anton Bruckner in his symphonies, who was definitely in the same mold. And Bruckner just worshipped Wagner without any reserve. And in his seventh symphony, there is dedication to Richard Wagner. Wagner had passed away, and so it is one of mourning music for Wagner, especially the Stromed Adagio. Hurry is certainly giving just this atmosphere immediately. Well, Bruckner is certainly very important here as a link to Jean Sibelius, because it is via Bruckner some Wagnerian influences are carried even to Sibelius. But if we now go to the even to north, north from Germany for Frenchmen is already a Nordic country, but in Finland, we noticed that the whole musical life, in fact, was very German-oriented in the 19th century. There were German musicians in the orchestra in 1882, when Robert Kajanus founded the Helsinki Philharmonic Orchestra. And in the same year, the conservatory was established in Helsinki by Martin Wegelius, who was a composer and absolutely very fervent Wagnerian, who wanted just to give this Wagnerian education to his pupils as well. In fact, even before them, the father of Finnish music was a German composer named Friedrich Paasius, who was a violin student of Louis Spohr from Kassel court, and then also studied their composition. And Paasius came to University of Helsinki as a music teacher and as a great violin virtuoso, and wrote the Finnish operas, or three stage works with music. However, Paasius was not Wagnerian. He didn't like Wagner at all, and the reason was certainly his teacher, Spohr, whom Paasius quite uncritically admired and adopted all his views. Now, Louis Spohr again knew Wagner rather well, and he didn't like in principle his music, but when Wagner was conductor in Dresden, then Spohr wanted to have his opera performed there. So he sent the libretto and score to Wagner, and Wagner tells this story in his Mein Leben, that he got this score, he was quite quite worried what to do, because he saw immediately that the opera was not to be performed, well, good enough for him. Now, he invented that there was another conductor in the opera, and he invented that this this task belonged to this to the area of this other. So he got rid. But the Wagner, however, spoke quite respectfully about Spohr, who certainly was the most important opera composer in the Europe before Richard Wagner. So we have this, but because of this Spohr connection, Fabricius never adapted any Wagnerian musical or dramatic techniques which would have been good for him, because he neither ever got his operas performed in the Central Europe, in Germany, which he deeply wished. So they stayed here in Finland with their Swedish texts and some kind of Singspiel, and did not become well known at all elsewhere. So that is the background. And then after Fabricius in the University of Helsinki came another teacher from Germany, again Richard Valtin. So Finland was really lucky to get these two really top German musicians to establish the musical life. So we have to be very happy and grateful about that. Richard Valtin was an organist and composer and choir director who continued the Fabricius tradition with the university choirs and also some opera performances which he conducted. In 1876, both, namely Martti Wegelius and Valtin, they went to the opening of Bayreuth. So they were the two Finns who were present there. And as a German, Valtin could also, of course, quite fluently talk with Wagner, and they had communication. Valtin told to Wagner how much his music was loved in Finland. Then Wagner answered, "Es freut mich sehr, dass können Sie hören, dass meine Musik so viel geliebt in dort am oben." So that I'm very pleased to hear that my music is loved there up so much. "But come you rather here to listen to it," he advised to Valtin. So that was the situation when Jean Sibelius came to picture from Hämeenlinna. He moved from Hämeenlinna to music studies to Helsinki, to conservatory, and became pupil of Wegelius, who immediately noticed his great talents. Now, Sibelius, of course, his first intention was to become a great violinist, but he was too nervous to get such a job. Anyway, Sibelius was sent rather soon to studies in Berlin. That happened in 1889, I think, at the end of these years, and he got a very Becker, a very strict counterpoint teacher, very German authoritative teacher as his supervisor, and started his studies. But in fact, he spent very Bohemian life with Scandinavian composers and colleagues, and really very Bohemian, which caused that he had to be hospitalized at least three times, and his relatives and friends in Finland were right quite upset to get new and new demands of more and more grants and scholarships to support. For instance, Wagner was then already performed in Berlin Opera, and Sibelius thought that he must have the right to sit in the best lodge in Berlin Opera House to hear the whole Nibelungenring, and so he asked from the Senate in Helsinki just more grant for that, and I think he was given. So he got his Wagnerian impulses, and they were very important. And in his early works, we can already hear something. What comes to my mind in the first place is this piano quintetto in G minor, piano string quartet, which he did not accept in his official catalogue of opuses. but which was discovered rather late, I would say, and which only now is being performed a little bit more. Well, to have some parallel, we have other Scandinavian composers who, of course, were interested in Wagner. For instance, Christian Sinding. I give you only one example, his famous Klavierstück, Frühlingsrauschen. Some kind of Wagnerian influence. But anyway, Sibelius wrote his quintetto, which is in five movements. It's a very big work, very monumental, and extremely difficult to perform. So it was written for Ferruccio Busoni. Busoni was then in Helsinki, as you know, in his first post as a piano teacher at the Vigelius Institute. He was an Italian virtuoso young pianist. He got his post by Hugo Riemann, who recommended him to Vigelius and who then took him. And so Busoni spent, I think, 1 year in Helsinki before he continued to Moscow. Anyway, Busoni married with the daughter of sculptor Sjöstrand, so Gerda Sjöstrand became his wife. But Busoni and Sibelius got good friends, and they had the club which convened in the restaurant Kämppi in Helsinki. It was called Leskovites because Busoni had a huge Newfoundland dog called Lesko. Anyway, this was written for Busoni, but Busoni never himself performed, but only three first movements. And that happened in Åbo, Turku, 1893. So it was only Sibelius' pianist and writer friend Adolf Pau who performed it until the end, so it is such to be. But if we... and this is a kind of, how would I say, sketch or draft or plan for his first major orchestra work, namely Kullervo Symphony, which I mentioned already in my previous lectures, because Kullervo is a hero from Kalevala, Finnish national epos of mythology, and he has a similar story as Siegfried and Oedipus. So he belongs to that category of heroic stories. And this has also, Kullervo Symphony is monumental. It has choir, Kullervo and his sister, and then big orchestra. There are orchestral movements, but then narration is given to the choir. Very much in the sense of antique tragedy, like where the choir has such a role. But anyway, it opens with the grave. We have this theme, and then we have main theme. Thank you. later goes to directly to Kullervo also. But you hear this D minor, it is balladic tonality key, and this empty fourth, fifth fill, just like in Flying Dutchman of Wagner. And especially I would say that in the last movement, which is balladic. So this is somehow Sibelius before Sibelius, but very exciting and by form fragmentary, but quite interesting. And at the end we namely have this type of in D minor, and then the end is almost violent outburst. It should be played. It comes vivace, and then there is this motif of hunting motif, or I would say the galloping horses. Just here. And poco poco accelerando until we reach the finale. Prestissimo, it must be played as fast as possible. It's like Richard Strauss said that if it's written sehr schnell, then spielen sie noch zweimal schneller. So that so if you see indication fast, then play twice faster. Anyway, so Sibelius was obviously Wagner had a great impact on him. His teacher Becker understood his student and gave some merit to this quintetto, which then was withdrawn from performance altogether. Now, then in these years, Kullervo was premiered in 1892 with a huge success, and at once Sibelius became the national hero, some kind of a true founder of Finnish art music. He has thoroughly found the musical language with which the whole Finnish nation could identify and itself. But in Germany, he heard more, and then he paid these obligatory trips to Bayreuth. Of course, he was sent to Bayreuth, and he was first very, very enthusiastic. So he heard 1894 Parsifal in Bayreuth, and he wrote to his bride Aino, heard Parsifal. Nothing in the world has ever made so overwhelming an impression on me. All my innermost heart strings throbbed. I can't begin to tell you how Parsifal has transported me. Everything I do seems so cold and feeble by its side. That is really something. However, a little bit later, when he was already left, had left Bayreuth for Munich, he had also some objections, and he wrote about Wagner. I've been studying Wagner. Everything seems familiar and clear. Wagner's music does not have an overwhelming effect on me in every respect. In my view, it is altogether too well calculated. I do not like it when a piece of music is so carefully worked out. Besides, his musical ideas themselves strike me as manufactured, not fresh. One can't hammer out themes by force, but one must accept on or reject them when they come. But anyway, then he heard also Meistersinger and the whole Ring tetralogy. except Rheingold, and got this very strong impacts. Later he in his life he tried to totally ignore his Wagner fever, which under which he had gone, because almost every composer fell under Wagner's power. His brother-in-law, Armas Järnefelt, who was conductor and composer, in the same way got under Wagner's impact. And also Robert Kajanus, his colleague and conductor. Kajanus wrote, in fact, the first symphonic work using Kalevala, namely Aino, symphonic poem Aino with male choir. And its style is more the early Wagner of Lohengrin, its sonority with harps and chromatic melodies. But anyway, so he even quoted the Abendmahl motif in his letter to, let's see it here, Aino. So that is the truth about this. But then in, of course, in Kullervo, the very theme itself, that there is Kullervo and his sister who by accident fall in love. So this is Schwesterliebe, this incest motif. It was there just to pour épaté la bourgeois, so to say. That is something joining him to Wagner, but certainly Kullervo and sister, the, as characters, are completely different from Siegmund and Sieglinde. Siegmund and Sieglinde, they are very human and very intimate, whereas Kullervo and sister are very archaic, archaic by their behavior and nature, and Kullervo especially is more like Siegfried or Parsifal, so somehow ignorant on what they do. So in Kullervo there are some moments which some chords which evoke Wagner, and for instance when the they meet Kullervo's sister three times, it happens always 1 second interval higher in three different tonalities. It's the same like in Tannhäuser. Tannhäuser's song for Venusberg is built in the same manner, gradually in the rising melody. So there might be some idea in that. So we can say, but and then of course in his symphonic poems, in Lemminkäinen Suite, there are certainly Wagnerian influences. For instance, in the Swan of Tuonela, in the English horn solo, may evoke Tristan, just the English horn solo of the sailor man at the beginning of the third act. So there might be some similarity. Yes. Otherwise, in later symphonies, I don't know. I already mentioned when we spoke about it was about yes, Götterdämmerung, where the Siegfried climbs up to the rock of Brünnhilde. We have this solo violin motif. Solo, and Sibelius' fourth symphony, we have the violin. Somewhat similar idea, very hard to say whether Sibelius had this in his mind when he wrote. But then, of course, there were other Wagnerians like Ilmari Kroon, who was professor of musicology and a very famous music scholar, having studied Finnish folk songs and invented a classification of the religious songs, popular songs of Finland, in his doctoral thesis. And by the way, Kroon was the first professor of musicology in the University of Helsinki. But Kroon was very Wagnerian, certainly, and he was under the impact of Alfred Lorenz, whom we remember. Lorenz was the famous Wagner scholar who wrote the book Das Geheimnis der Form by Richard Wagner, The Secret of the Form at Richard Wagner. And Lorenz had a very strict formal method, claiming that Wagner's music was symphonic and based on this old medieval Minne song form, Stollen Abgesang, so AAB form. And now Ilmari Kroon brought this model and applied it directly to Sibelius' music. However, he transformed this rhythmic analysis in his according to his own theory of musical rhythm. But then he made also these leitmotif charts or diagrams in which every symphony theme in Sibelius was treated like a Wagnerian leitmotif, so that they were given names or titles which referred to various programs. And Kroon claimed that these programs might have been in the mind of Sibelius when he wrote the symphony, in such a way that the first Sibelius symphony was the Kullervo, second one was the Finnish battle for independence, fourth symphony was the landscape in Koli, Joensuu, and so. Now Sibelius, when Kroon around 1947, I think this was really this monumental two-part study in German, when Kroon showed that to Sibelius in Ainola, Sibelius of course politely received it, but wrote in his diary that he certainly never thought anything like that, and that the whole day was spoiled because of this Kroon visit. That was perhaps too rude, but anyway, Sibelius never thought that his music would be in that way programmatic, and he rather than belonged to that Johannes Brahms party of absolute symphonism and wanted to be put to that. Sibelius never seriously tried opera. He had this Maiden in the Tower, but and of course Kullervo comes rather close to operatic discourse in some parts, but Sibelius got a deep inferiority complex in Bayreuth when he saw how famous Wagner was, and he noticed that I could never establish around me such a worshipping community around my work and my philosophy, because Sibelius was non-verbal. He never wrote any theories of art like Wagner to support his visions. So, and Sibelius was also a very slow developing composer. Well, Wagner was not also in his time, but when he came to Berlin, if you compare him to Richard Strauss, they are of the same age. Richard Strauss was already having a very brilliant career as a conductor and also as a composer. So he was much ahead to Sibelius in those years. Later I've heard from one source that Richard Strauss said about Sibelius that Ich kann mehr, aber ist größer. I can more, but he is greater. But I don't know whether this oral tradition is true. So we have to leave Sibelius with his Wagner, and in Finland, if there were any other Wagnerians, Wagner's ideas were taught in Sibelius Academy by Arvo Laitinen, who was a theory teacher, who made also the Finnish translation of all the leitmotifs of Wagner, and who also tried to teach Wagnerian composing to his students. That's something that I know. But otherwise, we have to leave now Sibelius and this Wagner reception. So Wagner was just one phase in Sibelius's education and growth. And this evokes me still one thing I forgot to tell about Marcel Proust and Wagner, namely why Parsifal was so important to both of them. Now Parsifal, the plot is such one that there's a young man who is totally ignorant and incompetent and helpless, and he gradually becomes conscious of himself, and at the end he takes the role as a king, as a redemptor of all the other people there. In Marcel Proust's novel A la recherche du temps perdu, the narrator is first also quite a young man who doesn't know anything, but then in seven novels he gets older and he gets all these experiences, and at the end he's a writer. So it is a kind of a Bildungsroman, how he becomes an artist who can then reveal the truth, you could say. No, I don't say that such progress would have been in any of these composers in the north, but anyway, Wagner is a part of our traditions here, and especially now, of course, Wagner is more and more popular and performed. Now, at the end, I would like to go back to Wagner's life and also a little bit back to semiotics. I promised to tell you in one of my schedule that there will be some methodological advice. Now, I don't want to bother you with too heavy theories, but because I'm writing myself a book about Wagner, a treatise, rather substantial, I would say, and I'm using there a certain kind of semiotic methodology, which I have been developing in recent years, and which I call existential semiotics. And I would like to just tell you about this method, and that it comes from German philosophy of Hegel and his categories of an sich sein and für sich sein, to be in oneself and to be for oneself. To be in oneself means anything as such by its qualities, an sich sein. And für sich sein means that this entity is somehow brought to society and defined by others. So this basic scheme I enriched by adding there from French philosophy, from Paul Ricoeur and Jacques Fontanie, pupil of Gramas, founder of Paris School, categories of moi and soi. Moi, me, and soi, society. And then we get not two categories of being, but four. We have an mir sein, für mich sein, für sich sein, and an sich sein. And these simply portray, an mir sein is simply the body, human body, as it is. Body, it's kinetic energy, core, like Plato said, and later Julia Kristeva, direct emotional, chaotic, without any structure yet. When this body, by growth and education, becomes a person, it reaches this second, namely this für sich sein, which I call moi two. Moi one was the body first. Moi two is just the body as a person, as an actor, as a personality. Idee der Persönlichkeit, from the Schnellmann member. And then on the other we have society, soi. An sich sein is soi one. It means the values and norms of a society as abstract things. And when they are become more substantial, they are enacted in certain practices and institutions, then they get soi too, or just the für sich sein. So we have four cases altogether. So Moa 1, Moa 2, Sua 2, Sua 1. And they are not only like a kind of semiotic square, quite achronic, abstract categorization. By the way, this kind of square exists already in Aristotle and in the logics of antiquity and their philosophers. No, there is a dynamic movement from moi, body, by a person, to practices and to society values, and then another movement from the values by a practice and person to body. And I call these movements, they are either it is sublimation, so body, which is corporeal, becomes incorporeal and spiritual in sua, sublimation. And on the other hand, this values, norms, they get embodied. So there's embodiment when they get, well, let's say this is abstract, let's say concretely, let's say that if the value, say, is music, sua one, music needs practices, institutions, conservatory, ballet school, opera, must be sua two. Conservatory needs certain persons which are apt to become musicians by their mind. So, and then these persons, they must have certain bodies. Let's say, if you want to be a pianist, you must have hands. If you want to be a singer, you must have lungs and you must have the right breathing. If you want to become a blow instrumentalist, then you must have the mouth, etc. So you must have certain physical, quite corporeal qualities. And so there are these two movements, and that's why I call this model tsemik. Tsemik. Tset is the form inside in two ways, and then emic term comes from an American linguist, Kenneth Pike, who by the term emic called linguistic categories which were internal, inner. Its opposition was ethic or ethicist, they were external categories. So my model which I applied then to Wagner is just this tsemik, tset plus emik. Moreover, in my model, as in my in my earlier studies I have tried to show, you need to read that you can start, for instance, my first book in this line was entitled Existential Semiotics by Indiana University Press in 2000, where I give my, and there I start from the Dasein. Dasein, it's Heidegger, is the world in which we live, subjects and objects. But beyond Dasein there is the transcendence, something which is out. And in fact, very much our lives in Dasein is determined by what is transcendental. The transcendental is certainly a very tricky notion. It is used by philosophers through centuries, classical ages, and also by theology, let's say so. Immanuel Kant spoke about transcendental and transcendent. So transcendental was meant just the theological life and death, and transcendent was just simply how does Ding an sich appear to us via these categories which were time, place, and subject. But anyway, the easiest way to determine transcendence is certainly it is anything which is absent but present in our mind, our minds, so we can think about it. And so our subject living in this tsemik model, this body, person, etc., he is able to transcend at any time, any moment. He's able to stop this movement of forces. And he can either affirm or deny anything, and then transcend. Now, this might seem, but you must study this more. I have no time here to explain, but what this has to do with Richard Wagner? Well, I have shared you a small article in which I already give some hint in this direction. So what would be Wagnerian body, Wagner's person and Wagner's practice, his role as a composer, and then which kind of values and norms he followed in his life. Now you must notice, if you study composer, that this is on semic level, but when a composer writes music, composition, that is certainly representation of this primal semic idea. It is not directly the same as so Wagnerian body in here concretely, physically, is not the same as the ideal Wagner body in his music. So we can say that in music the semic body is simply the kinetic energy of music. It's clang, it's sound, it's first occurrence and first mode of existence without any kind of structure or form, so to say. And then person becomes a musical actor, theme, melody. It is any element in musical composition with which we can identify as something, some kind of anthropomorphic figure there. So musical themes and actors. Then praxis, certainly. Music is full of different praxises. Musical forms, sonata, rondo, fugue, genres, church music, chamber music, symphonic music, opera music, rhetorics, ellipse, anaphora, katabasis, anabasis. So we have a lot of these aspects which belong to this musical praxis, which is topics, as we said already, which are of social origin. And then finally we have the values, the aesthetic ideas, what they are, beauty, religious devotedness, patriotism in music, nationalism in music, and many others. So I mean that on musical level, I call this sigtemic, they are signtemic, we are on a level of representation, and certainly between the real life and representation there is always a gap, there is an articulation. So, articulation, that is linguistics, André Martinet. In language we have the first primary articulation and secondary, but that's another story. Now, let's look in Wagner's life finally, and we can say that there are many aspects here. I spoke about his body, but by the way, one source, I spoke also about sources, one source which is very important is of course not only his My Life, Mein Leben, in which he quite concretely portrays himself, and we can see there are these four modes of being, like semic analysis. But another one which is also extremely fascinating is Cosima Wagner's Tagebücher, or diaries, from 1865 to 1882. Because Cosima wrote down events in every day of Richard, from morning till late night, and even in the evening, night, how he slept, whether it was bad or well or not so well. So I mean that we can, when we read these sources, especially Cosima's Tagebücher, which I think I have, yes, I have it here. Here is the, you know, there are four books like this, printed rather dense. I'm sorry, it started 1869, not 65, 69. So Cosima Wagner, Tagebücher. The problem here is that there is of course no plot here. The the events go as low as the life itself. So, and in order to find those most exciting points of Wagner's verbal expressions, which Cosima also quotes, you have to read everything. You must go through everything, and I indicated here some with some papers just those most interesting things. And exciting is that what Wagner said quite unofficially, beyond his official writings, for Cosima, let's say in the morning breakfast table or at the dinner or when they are walking in the garden somewhere or traveling, what he says laconically and shortly is often much more striking and just and correct than his theoretical developments, which are a very figurative language and so to say unclear, not conceptually well thought, because he was totally unable to portray conceptually what he was doing as an artist. That's a fact. So that when he, for instance, says that suddenly that modern music starts with C sharp and then Beethoven Eroica, you see the theme, it is E flat major, which suddenly goes to E flat D C sharp. So that is the that deviation from the key is just the birth of modernism. So statements like that are very terribly exciting, and we can only think what consequences they might have in the musical history. Such things we really find here in Cosima. Of course, he did the same as Richard, I mean, he a little bit changed, somehow transformed. I don't say that he falsified things, but for instance, when this was ready, these diaries, it was only intended to their children, and they are used not to officially use it at all. And Cosima thought that she will give that to her daughter Eva, and Eva should read them and then burn diaries and destroy them altogether. Now, Cosima lived until 1931, and when she passed away, then Eva did not destroy them, fortunately, but instead she took away some pages and just made some texts unreadable. So it was, of course, quite stupid. But anyway, the diaries remained, and I must say that it is extremely valuable document. I would even say that, I don't say that Cosima would have tried to be a novel writer or something like that, but he's just reporting, because she knew that she was living with a man who was something exceptional. So this evokes me that how the French semiotician and psychoanalyst Julia Kristeva wrote a book, Génie Féminin, so the woman genius, and for her they were Hannah Arendt, the Jewish philosopher, Melanie Klein, the anthropologist, and Colette, who wrote such easy demi-monde novels of Parisian life. Then for me, if I would make a list of my génie féminin, they would be Georges Sand, Cosima Wagner, and Simone de Beauvoir for the 20th century. So, but now, let us see. Let us a little bit have a look still about, because I promised this is Wagner, life and work. Body, we already know that that Wagner's body was short, but quite acrobatic. He was very good. He was mountain climber. He made long walks all the time with his life, but his stomach was always in disorder, and he went off to the sanatoria, which gave him water treatment. It was its only worsened situation radically, and he had many problems in with his health, and then at the end he got these heart problems in the breast, so which were not diagnosed in the correct way. So Wagner's person we must need to become their personality. Many had a very negative view on his person because he did things which really are out of order. So, like marriage with Cosima, for instance. And then this personality mixed with his, let's say, Sua Wan, this last category, his values and norms, made a rather strange combination because he started to write these pamphlets rather early. And these pamphlets were some kind of a hatred speech of his time because he was just against everything what he thought was foreign, and especially French culture, French and also Italian culture, so the southern culture. Then against the Jews, because he thought that the Jewish people had made a conspiracy against his composer role by preventing that his works were not performed in Europe as they would have deserved. So he was quite paranoid, and his reasoning was extremely damaging his reputation and violating many people and breaking his friendships. But he was a kind of media figure before his time. He knew that better the people talk about me something than that there would be deep silence. So he became well known with these writings, which really became quite disastrous for his career. So it is this anti-Semitism, which I have not touched very much here, because I would like to say some facts about this anti-Semitic attitude. For the first, in his time, when he published this, some doctors already wrote articles about him, and they tried to prove that he was totally mad and crazy, he was paranoid, and that he had all kinds of strange issues. I have just tried to. Yes, this is especially one book by rather early by Herr Müller. Wait a minute, I get it here. Yes, it's here. It was Dr. Putschmann. Wagner as a psychiatric case appeared in 1873 in Berlin, entitled Richard Wagner and a psychiatrische Studie. And the writer was a practicing doctor and a specialist from Munich. And he starts from the point that the nerve system, which is somehow damaged, is a precondition for genius. And the congenial people are often in their external behavior peculiarities, totally senseless, so melancholy is the heritage of genius. So furor poeticus, the furor, poetic furor was known. And then he applies, and for him the real Wagner died with Lohengrin, Swan Song. All the music he wrote thereafter was a sign of the crazy vanity and totally mad imagination, and of his limitless self-admiration and egoism. So he criticizes everything, and also his writings, they are humbug as a metaphysical verbal thing. So it was already strongly criticized in his time. There is one book which is rather funny, namely Wilhelm Tappert put together in one book all the utterances and arguments against Wagner in the book Richard Wagner im Spiegel der Kritik, Wörterbuch der Unhöflichkeit enthalten grobe, höhnende, gehässige und verleumderische Ausdrücke, die gegen den Meister Herr Wagner, seine Werke und seine Anhänger von den Feinden und Spöttern gebraucht worden. So, dictionary of all the unpolite sayings about containing the rough mocking hostile expressions against Master Wagner, his work, and his supporters by enemies and those who are just mocking him. And it's a dictionary. It is extremely thick book. There are such terms like absurdity, ape, alchemist, albinist, antichrist, Beelzebub, brutal, kankan, chaos, Dalai Lama, decadent, delirium, dilettante, Don Quixote, enfant terrible, Grobian, hypnotic, hysteric, Jesuit-like, cacophonic, caricaturist, cattle noise, cat music, coquetry, langweilig. They say that Five Dutchman is the most boring opera ever written. Vices, all vices get lost. Mameluk, Marsuas, Medusa, Moloch, Monstros, Motivic, illness, musical pope, nerves, emptiness, needs, opium, orgies, pathos, plague, Bayreuth rabbi, rat, charlatan, terrible, schoolmaster, self-worshipping, sophist, skeleton, sterility, sin, devilish noise, trivial, unlucky, unmusical, destruction, vandal, Wagneritis, Wagneropsy, Walter von der Pfingst, by the soul. So it's very, and we have had also other opinions of him. Here in Finland, Dr. Joel Haatila has published in an article about Fine Dutchman and speak about the manic depressivity of Wagner's mind personality. Well, this, but we must remember that this kind of madness was also a kind of fashion in the Romantic time. It was just a fashion which made you popular and well-known as an artist. Robert Schumann is one case, and Charles Rosen has studied Schumann and said that that this individual psychological study does not help us in any way to understand the works of artists and their reception. Charles Rosen said, "Too firm an identification of an element in the work with an aspect of the artist's life does not further understanding but block it." So, and he says, Schumann's genius was as destructive as it was creative. So, also Wagner's dreams, because have been studied. Cosima wrote down every morning the dreams, because Wagner told Richard told him which kind of dreams he had had. And there is one study about his dreams, which I would like to show to you. It's a French study by Philippe Müller, Wagner par Serev, Wagner by his dreams. And so here are just listed all the dreams that there are hundreds, what were the themes of the dreams? And we have a list of such topics as Cosima, frustration, great dream, family, vanity and favor of the king, Minna, nightmare, death, rivality with Franz Liszt, money, Hans von Bülow, reference to parapsychology, Jews, theories of rel, culpability, prison, prison. And then thematically, the study that there were the 30 major categories, there were aggression in general, second, humiliation, third, assistance, autonomy, consideration, affiliation, curiosity, danger, punishment, assignment, fight, sensuality, mental sensuality, physical sensuality, all kinds of sensualities, to avoid the suffering. And so they have been studied quite seriously. It might be interesting to notice. Now, anyway, this anti-Semitism was a strong feature in Cosima also, because Cosima suffered a personality disturbance. She was daughter of Franz Liszt and Marie Dagut, but Franz Liszt had almost abandoned his children, didn't care about them, and so Cosima was married with Hans von Bülow, a pupil of Liszt, and brought to Berlin, where she lived most together with her mother-in-law. And her life was very, very sad altogether, until he made in Paris, met for the first time Paris Richard. And so Cosima had a deep inferiority complex. He felt herself very, very low and very inferior. That's why he wanted to have a father figure, Richard, to replace his real father. And he wanted to have that one group of people should be even below her, and they were just these Jewish people. And so Cosima's anti-Semitism was quite systematic and fixed, whereas in Richard Wagner's case it was extremely flexible and contradictory, we could say. Anyway, Wagner's utterances, sayings, and his acts were often in complete contradiction. And the first noteworthy thing here is that this anti-Semitism does not play explicitly any role in his operas. He never mentions anything of that, or puts there anything libretto which would be a reference to this. Really, I encourage you to study them seriously. But now, so all the invitations are just post and ad hoc invitations, and there is a British scholar, Brian Maggie, who states in Wagner and Philosophy, his book, that his speech sounded different in the context of 19th century than now. Now we know to which terrible thing this anti-Semitism led in the 20th century, but in the 19th century it had not yet happened at all. That was something that Pierre Boulez also told me when I spoke with him about this in Helsinki. And remember, Richard passed away 83, and these events, Holocaust, started in the 1930s. So 50 years later, you can say. But then some intellectuals like Zizek speaks about messages which are prophecies and which fulfill themselves. And some stage directors have taken these Wagner's writings quite seriously and based all the staging upon them, like Philippe Godefroy in France. So his Parsifal mise-en-scène reveals Wagner's basic fascist ideology and anti-Semitism. So he thinks that Wagner's music is totally ideological and so. But it is not quite that. American New Musicology is represented by Mark Weiner in this study, which has been much then voted by and become very influential. Richard Wagner and anti-Semitic imagination. And his thesis is simply that although Wagner never mentioned this in his operas, it was known by the caricature figures, which were some grotesque figures, which were some kind of Jewish elements in his operas. So he claims that the whole audience in the 19th century knew exactly that let's say Alberich, Mime, and Beckmesser, they were in fact caricaturesque Jewish figures. But it is very, very difficult to prove this, because it is never explicit and never mentioned there. It is something like someone told that the best proof of Kandinsky's Japanese impact is that you can never see it there, and that Kandinsky never speaks about that. So we must not be anachronistic and project our time's views to something which happened in the 19th century. Yes, but that is very strong. And Mark Weiner has become a kind of prophet for French intellectuals who have written about Wagner. Here I have a book by the famous Žižek, or how you pronounce, Variation Wagner, Slavoj Žižek, Variation. And Badiou, Cinq leçons sur le cas Wagner. Badiou, Alain Badiou, very famous writer and philosopher in Paris, and they all accept just this Weiner arguments without ever studying themselves, the music and the scores by themselves. So I don't think it is quite convincing if you have really not studied them in that case. So Wagner, in fact, he did not believe in Bismarck's Germany, and he was rather yes. True is that that he's that his anti-Semitism came just from his experiences with Meyerbeer and others in Paris, and then he just expanded this theory to these dimensions which were quite impossible. And then we have noticed also that Wagner was, in fact, he was a socialist until 40 years old age, and only later he became more conservative. And then, but even then, just only so talk about German culture, nothing about German state itself. He was all the time surrounded by great Jewish musicians, and he was totally depending on their work. Mostly these two conductors, Hans Richter, who was his favorite conductor, and then Hermann Levy, who conducted Parsifal. So he could not even think Parsifal without Hermann Levy. So he did not treat Levy very well in Wahnfried, but always when he had done something negative, he had to excuse and write letters apologizing his behavior. And then Hermann Levy, who was also a Wagnerian, he accepted and returned there. So that is, and then every night in Wahnfried, Joseph Rubinstein played by piano Johann Sebastian Bach Prelude and Fugue. So that's something that we have to remember all the time. But true that Wagner was in connection with Arthur Gobineau, who was a famous French writer and who published that very questionable book, Essai sur l'inégalité des races. But Gobineau was not anti-Semite, he was against other races. By the way, Gobineau perhaps visited even Finland with the Brazilian Emperor Pedro II, who came here around 1826. So Wagner was very, it's very complex, this question altogether, but I have to mention it because many people talk about it, and many still based in German opera houses, very much they took this on the staging, which is certainly not at all the idea of Richard Wagner, not in any case. But let's see the closure of Cosimas Tagebücher, because they are so interesting. Just that which type of stories he's telling. What is that in there? He tells, beginning in 1869, that in January we spoke of Schopenhauer, and he tells how this had said to Karl Ritter, who was my assistant, I admire Wagner as a poet, but he is not at all a musician. This expression, ich admiriere Wagner, was very much amusing Richard, and he thought that in any case it was better than if he had taken him as a musician, but not as a poet. Then he wanted to send to Mrs. Bismarck his book Deutsche Kunst und Deutsche Politik, if that would somehow change, that also her husband Bismarck would get closer to the German art, but then Gosse advised to give up because that might cause a misunderstanding. So here also. Then he got a letter from Franz Liszt, from father, who says that passion will fade away, but the conscience pains will remain. So it was just this. So then he speaks about Mozart, whose music is like a realm of plants, whereas from Beethoven on, there will be anima. Bach views are like a big three, sublime but also upsetting, but in a different way than the human heart. Richard speaks about Odysseus and Ilias, and then drinks beer. So we see all aspects are here. All relation with the external world, even most kindest, is devastating for us, because Richard gets so nervous. He speaks about the Freude theme, Freude schöne Götterfunken, how the all wisdom, all poetry stops in front of this naive theme and its divine character. Richard returns from the town in which the dogs have bitten him. So he always had, by the way, dogs, and there are dogs have their own graveyard also. Richard plays Beethoven symphonies. Richard, by joke, says that he doesn't want to compose any tragical stories any longer. Professor Nietzsche is invited for a birthday. Cosima always calls Nietzsche, young man, as Professor Nietzsche. She never forgets it. After the meal, we make music with Richard, Haydn symphonies. Then we play four-handed Mozart. We speak about Lohengrin and said that Röckel said that we need a new national anthem. I would have already a theme, and he sung the motif from Lohengrin, third act march, but Röckel found it too difficult, too günstig. Then the family Zerov visits from Russia, and they tell about the story at the Finnish waterfall, where he discovers some verses signed by Richard Wagner. But then Cosima says, "Aber Richard ist nie dort gewesen." No, I have discussed this, so there is this poem, which of course is it's quoted by Hannus Salmi, I think, here it is. It was written in French, this poem. But it was discovered at the Vuoksi River at Lower Pavilion at Imatra Rapids in 1863, and then published in the Finnish by the Finnish newspapers. "I'm leaving for Germany. Adieu, delightful country. Adieu, my much beloved Russians, a noble and intelligent nation. You alone have known how to appreciate my divine music. You alone have applauded my sublime creations, which were greeted in Paris, that center of ignorance, with whistles. To reward you, my dear Sarmatian music lovers, I swear, before this waterfall, to compose an opera wherein the principal hero shall be this Imatra. The other roles shall be taken by rocks, by fir trees, by fish, etc. Possibly it may be worthwhile to insert a man into this scene as well, but that point has not been decided yet, Richard Wagner." So it was the Borgo Bladet, and then Obo Underrättelser published it 6 years later, 69. So now this has been studied also in Finland, whether that would have been possible, and of course it would have been possible in context of his journey. One critic here in Finland studied even the weather conditions, whether it was able to come by a slide from Petersburg to Imatra, but I don't know. Interesting is the note on January that he says that arithmetic is to music the same as word is to concept. Musician who from morning, early morning to the evening, only makes music and does not take into account the conceptual world is like a cow. He's lacking more than the person without knowing anything about music regards the world. So he didn't understand those musicians who were only, let's say, playing from morning to night without ever reading anything, without having any so-called classical education, bildung in a broader sense. So that was that we have to remember, that these great romantics, Wagner, Liszt, and these are, they were also extremely well-read people and who know the whole culture